how did you become interested in gerontology?
It was a little bit of an accident of fate. I was at a position that the institution was changing dramatically in its direction. So I was looking for new opportunities. And I had actually worked mostly at the younger age of development, not at the older age. I studied myelin development and the role of proteolipid proteins in myelin development. But as I was looking around at opportunities, I saw this ad at the National Institute on Aging, where they were interested in somebody who worked in animal models. And so I thought, it's a good fit. I'd done maybe one or two experiments where I had actually looked at what was going on in the age of animals. But I consider development and aging to be just opposite ends of a spectrum. And so I thought I had experience that the NIA would be interested in. And I thought it was a completely different type of opportunity as far as coming into the extramural program, where now I live vicariously through other people's successes, and I help create and support the resources that give our investigators the opportunity to really move ahead with their research. So I applied and got the position, and I've actually been there 16 years now. I'm very happy with the type of work I do, where I'm able to have a much greater impact, I think, on science than I ever would just as an individual researcher. And I've had to learn a lot about aging, and it's been quite an interesting trip through these 16 years of what we've learned and how far aging research has come.
Describe your career trajectory as a gerontologist. At what point in your career did you embrace gerontology to describe yourself?
I'm not sure that really quite fits for me. I certainly embraced the field immediately. I figured this is where I was going to be making my living. I wanted to dive in. I joined GSA the first year. That gave me an opportunity to meet people and start to understand where my gaps of knowledge were and start developing my career that way. But I think, I was pretty gung-ho when I first came to the NIA. Because it was a different approach, both in the type of work I was doing, but also the fact that it was now focusing on aging and not development, I pretty much dove in first, feet first, head first, whatever you want to call it. I'm not sure I'd ever really call myself a gerontologist, because to me that has more of a clinical feel to it. And I'm certainly not, I have a PhD in molecular biology, pretty useless for the clinic. So I'm not sure that that distinction really explains how I feel about myself in the field, because I felt this is my field, I'm going to dive in, have always, this is actually one of the reasons I'm sure that I stayed at the NIA 16 years, is that I not only have a good work environment within the NIA and a lot of mentorship there, but the field as a whole is very welcoming, and I am always treated like I am a member of the research community. Even though I'm in the extramural program, I'm not doing the work myself anymore. I am embraced by the community, and that's meant a lot to me. I don't think I would have stayed this long if I didn't have that feeling that I actually belong to a community now.
Did you have any female mentors who impacted your move going into gerontology?
Again, I did not have anyone at that time as I was making this transition to a new position that really impacted me. I've been very fortunate in my life to have some really great mentors. My postdoctoral mentor, Lynn Hudson, was just incredible in both her support. She helped me grow, but gave me a lot of latitude to, fall down now and then on my own, because you have to do that in order to learn. And she's continued. I've been very fortunate. She's continued throughout my career to always be there. When I was looking for a new job, she invited me to come and give a seminar and just to have a practice. She was still at NINDS at that time. She's now moved on to a private corporation, or private foundation. I've also been very fortunate, and I think this also plays into, again, why I've stayed at the NIA for 16 years, that we've had a series of deputy directors at the NIA, who each of whom have been a woman and each of whom has been an incredible mentor. Fox Sweddle, whom we've all heard about recently today, has just had a phenomenal career herself. But while she was deputy director, she was always there. And she was just the type of person that you could talk to and all of a sudden light bulbs would go off and you'd realize, okay, there's a lot of ways I can meet this challenge, not the one that I was fixated on. And I've kind of taken that as a way to help other people because I think it's very important. Judy Salerno followed her and then Marie Bernard, whom we also saw got a wonderful award yesterday. And she's also been a wonderful mentor for me. A lot of what I do is in managing the resource contracts, and I interact with her very regularly since she's very much involved in that as well from the higher standard standpoint. So I've had the opportunity to interact with Marie probably more than any of the other deputy directors, and it's been a great benefit. So I've really been fortunate in that standpoint. There have been other people who have been, you know, certainly very helpful in my career getting started here at the NIA. My first supervisor, Hubert Warner, was absolutely phenomenal. But I think that having a few women who were at positions that could really give me just that little extra support now and then when I was dealing with a challenge and I wasn't really sure what was the best way, to have someone to talk to and help illuminate the best way or other ways of thinking about things. A lot of times dealing with a challenge, it's all how you're thinking about it. Whether or not you do A, B, or C isn't necessarily going to impact the outcome, but how you think about it is going to help you get to either A, B, or C. And that's a big part of mentorship, I think, and I've been very fortunate at the NIA to have that.
What is unique about being a woman in the field of gerontology?
Well, I certainly think that women are underrepresented. I think that because women are often the caretakers, and we all speak in generalizations, and I certainly want to state up front, I recognize that there are a lot of men in caretaker situations as well, but I think that because women are often in a caretaker situation at different stages of their lives, they tend to look at things a little bit different, looking at not just what's happening at this particular juncture, but how is that going to impact the future? And I think that's very important. I think women bring a unique perspective to any field, and I think women face some unique challenges, both in juggling other types of responsibilities, but certainly, trying to say this as gently as possible, there is still a lot of bias in science. Is, I wouldn't say a man's world anymore, but it's still male-dominated, and in some situations, women are not necessarily still treated as equal. And I've seen this from remarks that individuals made, sometimes to a person much higher than them that happened to be a woman, to departmental decisions that are made where women were not given the same weight as men in those decisions. So in my own career, I've seen enough examples of the types of things that can happen if you're not vigilant and if you're not outspoken at times. And so women often, you don't want to seem aggressive, but you have to stand up for yourself. And that's, I think, where mentorship also comes in. Very important, because it helps women realize that, yes, I can stand up for myself without it being a negative attribute. Mm-hmm. It's simply, I'm going to state what my opinion is, or what my need is, or whatever.
And this isn't one of the questions, but just based on that, what has been your biggest challenge?
I think my biggest challenge, and I have to say, again, I'm very fortunate, working at the NIA, I don't see any gender gap. I don't see any difference in the way men are treated versus women. And it's been I think one of the joys, you hear so many bad things about working in the government these days, and actually to me, I've had every opportunity for my career to grow that any other person, regardless of sex, has had. So I feel that I'm in a very good position right now, that I'm not subjected to any kind of bias. But in my academic career, that wasn't always the case. And I think that just making sure that your voice is heard is the biggest challenge that a lot of women face, particularly at smaller universities. I think the lack of mentors, again, at smaller universities, which I did spend some time at, where at a larger university, there's a more diverse faculty, there's more of a concentration of faculty in any one particular scientific field. Mm-hmm. Smaller universities don't have that quite often, and so it's much harder to find mentorship. And I think that's where these professional societies are especially important, because you can meet people then that might be, you know, half a country away or a whole country away on the other coast, and yet will still be able to offer you that mentorship. Because it's something that we're not taught in graduate school, right, to stand up for ourselves, let alone to seek out mentorship, where, you know, you focus on the science. And I think it's very important for people not just to focus, they have to focus on their science, but they also have to focus on building a network, a support network. And the types of situations that we see at GSA, the different committees and the different projects that are going on, are really great ways for people to network.
Okay. I have one more question that's not on here.
Okay.
How do you avoid being labeled like the emotional angry woman while you're standing up for yourself? Because sometimes, like how you kind of said, sometimes you have to be assertive.
Mm-hmm.
And people often perceive being assertive and being a woman as being angry or overly assertive, or they just put a negative label on it.
Absolutely. I wish I had a nice pat answer for that one. I don't. What I can say is it is very important to try to keep the emotion separate from the response or the action. And I particularly am a very emotional person, and so at times my first reaction is a very emotional reaction, but I've learned to step back, evaluate it. It can be everything from just waiting a day to write an email to taking 5-10 seconds before you respond verbally to something, and make sure that how you construct that response is based on the actual event or topic that's being discussed and not an emotional response. But having said that, you can still be assertive and say, no, that's wrong, or, you know, whatever is the appropriate response, and not worry that, oh, they're gonna think I'm too aggressive as a woman. You can't have that as part of the equation. You have to focus on the functional answer and try to keep your emotions in check as you're making a response. And it's not an easy thing to do at times, especially when you are facing some sort of bias. You know, you want to slam your hand on the table or whatever. You don't want to do that. You want to respond with a solid justification, a solid answer.
Okay. How has being a gerontologist interacted with your own personal aging process?
Well, I'm certainly a lot more aware now of what I need to do to age successfully. It's one of the benefits of working at the NIA is I hear so much about so many different areas of research that are that's impacting our aging. When I first came here, I always looked at everything I learned as important for my mother's generation, and
right,
somewhere along the way that changed, and now I also look at it as important for me and for my peers and my generation.
Mm-hmm.
I think that if anything, I'm very heartened by the types of progress that have been made both in the science and in women's role in gerontology.
Mm-hmm.
and women's role in science as a whole. I find it very encouraging, the progress that's been made. So I think what I've learned over the years from my work and from going to meetings like GSA has been a very positive thing for me, looking at aging as a much more positive thing now instead of something to fear.
Awesome. The Women in Gerontology Legacy Project focuses on the legacies of older women gerontologists. Within that framework, is there anything else you would like us to know?
I can't think of anything. I think your questions have really covered a lot. Certainly the importance of mentorship, and as we have benefited from mentorship, mm-hmm. I think then as we get older, we have an obligation to pass that benefit to the next generation, which I try to do in my job in many different ways, both with the people that I work with, and certainly I interface with a lot of people in the research community through my work, and so I try to just be available for whatever types of help or mentorship I can provide.
What is the one thing that you would tell me as an aspiring researcher? And I say aspiring because I'm only in my second year, haven't really gotten into my dissertation, but what's the one takeaway that you would tell me to survive?
Thick skin, edit that one out. I think it's very important, as I mentioned earlier, about the networking. No man is an island, no woman is an island either. And I think it's very important to, as you're developing your career, to interface with people at your university, throughout even if you do a postdoc, as a postdoc, try to build connections. You never know when those connections are going to come back and be a benefit. But also, you never know what little piece of advice that somebody gives you now might turn out to be really valuable 10 years from now. And if it's a really good piece of advice, you'll remember it in 10 years. It's, I think, important to focus on what you're doing and building your science, but it's also important to do the networking. The balance is the important thing. And so one of the hardest things for me was to learn to say no. There, especially as a woman, you're often going to be pulled in multiple directions, asked to serve on a lot of committees. You have to balance that. You can't do everything that everybody wants you to do. And again, it varies a lot from the different types of academic, and I'm only speaking from academics. I have no idea how it works in industry. Mm-hmm. But it'll vary greatly from a large medical school down to a small university. So small university, every committee is going to say, oh, we have to have at least one woman on the committee. And if you happen to be one that says yes easily, they'll start coming to you on a regular basis. Mm-hmm. So you have to learn to say no, but you also have to evaluate each opportunity. It may look like it's just, oh, one more committee they want me on, but it might turn out that one or two of those committees are really an opportunity to both strengthen your career trajectory, but also to get to know people that may be very helpful later on, providing mentorship or even just opportunities that they will notice that they can bring to you. So I think you have to be very careful, and it all comes down to balance.
Okay. Good at saying no.
It took me, I won't even tell you how many years, it took a long time, because certainly, again, just speaking for myself, I always want everyone to like me, everyone to be happy with what I say, happy with how I respond to them. And so when we would have some really ugly faculty meeting interaction, I would go home and stew about it all night. Turns out everybody else went home, forgot about it, and it meant nothing to them. And here I am, you know, just taking it all home. And so I had to learn to evaluate what was going on, and was it something that I had control over first? Because there are times when things happen that you simply don't have control over, and then you do the best you can, and you accept whatever is handed down. But with the types of things where people start coming and wanting more and more from you, you have to be able at some point to say, no, I just can't take on one more responsibility.
And be okay with it.
And be okay with it.
Okay.
Absolutely.